All right, guys. So today we have a special treat. So we have Stacy Bahrenfuss. She is the founder and CEO of Catalyst Group, and she is the creator of the Limitless Realtor Circle, which we'll talk about here in a minute. But she is a rock star real estate agent. She has been in the business since she was 19 years old, which wasn't that long ago. It's only been about 14 years. She started young, but we are so excited because we're going to talk a lot about goal setting and mindset and all the things today. So welcome, Stacy, to the show. We're so happy to have you.
Thanks for having me, Stephanie. I'm happy to be here.
Absolutely. So when this episode airs, we're recording this fall winter of 2020. When this airs, it's probably going to be about the beginning to middle of January 2021. So it's going to be, everyone's going to be focused on goal setting and kind of the new year and all that kind of stuff. So I thought this was a perfect time to talk about how to start setting that up. And Stacy is an expert at really honing in on helping you figure out what it is you're looking for, even if it's different from the pack. So we're going to kind of dive into some things. But Stacy, why don't you give us a little bit of background about yourself so the audience kind of has some insight into where you are, where you come from. You're from Idaho, which is really cool. So share a little bit about yourself for the audience.
Yeah, absolutely. So I've been in Idaho for really most of my life. And when I was a senior in high school, was actually joking around with some friends and applied to be a sales coordinator. I'm sorry, the sales coordinator and or salesperson at a local real estate office that was a resort real estate office. And they ended up hiring me as their assistant. And so I was, you know, still a senior in high school, going to school, finishing that up, and then working part-time. And that's how I was introduced to the world of real estate. And everything changed because I'm, of course, you know, seeing these interactions and, you know, just the opportunity in real estate, and quickly changed my course of wanting to go into international business and go to college to what does it look like if I started this business now? And so that was the introduction into my career. And so by the age of 19, that's when I went and got licensed and started my real estate business. And so was a single agent for about 5 years, and then started building a team, you know, of assistants and other agents so that we could increase our volume and, you know, maintain that excellence in our service and quality care for our clientele. And, you know, started to build that and, you know, went through all of the struggles. Gosh, if I, you know, could.
What do you mean? There's struggles in real estate? It's not just showing pretty houses?
Yes. So much craziness behind the scenes. And so, you know, had a lot of growing pains, learning how to hire, learning how to lead, being a producer, all, you know, how that all balances out. And so wrapping my arms around that, I decided a couple of years ago that I wanted to go into the development and new construction side myself, because similar to you, you know, I've worked with a lot of the listing sides with builders and developers, and wanted to venture out and do it myself, because quite often opportunities cross our desk and, you know, we have to go out and get the builder, make sure he can afford it and make sure he follows through. And I just wanted to be empowered to make those calls if the right deal crossed my plate. And so one did. And so went after that in 2018 and built 11 custom homes and wanted to, of course, sell them as soon as possible, and ended up taking just until August of this year until they all sold. And so it was quite the journey. And yeah, have lots to share on that too.
And you were in the market during the crash of 08, 09 that I was in as well.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, that was just crazy, especially, I'm not sure when you started your career. When was that?
05.
05,
right out of college. Yep. I got new construction sales right out of college.
Yeah. And so it was so, I mean, different going into a new industry and not necessarily having a database or, you know, people that you knew for 20 years, like a lot of agents do, and just figuring out how to be successful in that.
Yeah. Yeah. So how is let's real quick recap 2020. What have you seen in your neck of the woods with COVID and just kind of this different year that we've had? And then what are you seeing into 2021 as far as the market goes?
Yeah. So in our area, we're seeing, you know, a lot of people 200 to 250 people a day moving to our area because I think COVID shocked a lot of people that were thinking about moving out of the big cities to fast forward that plan and process. And so they're moving here in groves and we're running into a lot of inventory issues, you know, as well, like we talked prior to hopping on live. And so, you know, new construction is absolutely leading the way, like in most markets. We have record low, you know, inventory and, you know, overall it's becoming an issue because builders are, you know, now having material costs change and pricing go up on that. And so buyers have to either go with that or wait until the house comes on. So it's this double-edged sword that we're seeing a lot of. Yeah. And, you know, as we go into 2021 with interest rates being as they are, I actually heard an analogy the other day, which I really liked. The lender said, interest rates fall like a feather and rise like a rocket ship. And so that was the first time I heard that. And, you know, interest rates have fallen over time to where they're at. And I think that combined with, you know, the economy overall will stay strong in 2021, but at some point we're going to have that shift because we just have to.
No, I agree with you. And the only thing I'm a little concerned about, to your point about the material costs, and we're seeing it all over as well with lumber, and then, you know, it'll be like, you'll watch the process go through. My husband still sells for in new construction and he'll come home and be like, all right, so windows are on back order. And then the other day we were in the car and he's talking to his builder and he's like, I'm waiting on carpet. Like, we don't know and we're getting it. And so it just seems like different stages of the process at random times are being affected with supply chain and materials or just costs in general, because I know, especially lumber, the mills shut down during COVID. And then they thought that housing was going to bust and it did the exact opposite, which I kind of figured, because when September 11th happened, I felt like everyone just got really down to the basics. They figured out what was important to them as just human beings. And the home is one of those things, right? And then you're in a pandemic and most people are like, hey, we want our four walls unattached if possible and a little bit of space. And that is lending itself to the homes. Everyone's loving the new construction. All of our listings are selling though, but to your point about new construction, if you're having inventory issues, what I tell my sales counselors that I work with is the great thing is you're not going to have buyers that are having to, you know, highest and best, multiple offers, because when you have 20 offers on a home that we're seeing with our listings, there's only one person getting that home. And so there's 19 other people out there that still need a home. And so the great thing is if they do work with a home builder, they can lock in their pricing, they can pick out some of their selections, get what they want. It may take a little bit more time, but that's a temporary kind of pain for the end goal.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
So as we go into 2021, you know, I think a lot of us, especially when you're in real estate, you know, like you said, you see the opportunity. I saw the opportunity when I got in as well. My mom is actually still a new construction sale. So I grew up in the model home. So that was just a natural next step for me. I was like, okay, I don't want to be a lawyer. I don't want to be a doctor. So real estate, absolutely. But I think that what I'm starting to see now is I'm on a team. I know you run a team and a brokerage. Like, tell me how you think real estate's changing from when you were an individual agent trying to do all the things to now you grew a team. And like you said, so you could harness that customer experience, but with doing probably more volume and just kind of have probably focus on what you do best and hire the other stuff out. How do you think real estate's evolving from when people go into real estate expectations and maybe, okay, they go into it for maybe flexibility or opportunity financially, but helping people really hone in on what's important so that they can get some of those things, but it's still line up with maybe their family goals. I know that's a big question. So how do you see real estate changing as maybe just the business in general, as far as agents versus teams and how, what you're seeing? And then we'll go to the second question, which is kind of more of the personal, like as we get into the new year, goal setting for the now versus I'll use myself as an example. I used to think more is always better. Mm-hmm. And I'll tell my age, I'm 38, I'm about to be 39 in February, but I'm starting to get more into the, hey, you need enough to have a good life. But then there is more to life than just that dollar that you're chasing, at least for me. And so it's kind of finding that balance and I think being okay with that and actually being okay to admit it. But I want to hear your thoughts and how you help agents set those goals. So maybe it'll help anyone listening kind of figure out. Because I know 2020 has been one of those years where I think a lot of people are sitting there kind of going, what's really important to me? You know, like, in a way, it's been a good reset. It's been difficult, I know, for a lot of people, especially if you're considered non-essential. And Texas, we were considered essential, so we still went on. But
yeah, it's such a great question, because it really applies to everything in life, right? I mean, it's not just real estate. And I'll go into that more in a second, just to talk, you know, about how real estate is changing and how to adapt, you know, as it evolves. I think what realtors need to understand is that the evolution of the real estate agent hasn't taken place since conception, right? If you look, I mean, in the early 1900s, it's, yes, technology has changed. Yes, you know, we do things way differently, you know, than we did then, from a logical, like tactical day to day. But I think that the evolution that is so important to focus on is how you are taking care of your clients, because at the end of the day, this is a relationship business. And if you can focus on your level of professionalism, your level of excellence, how you are the leader in your market, and it could be how you're the leader, you know, of yourself, and then of your team, and then of your brokerage. You know, it doesn't have to be this macro level, right? If you just get really focused on stepping into that leadership and raising your standard, you will be at the forefront of this evolution, you know, and to stay educated on the tools and video and integrate that into your world, because the industry is, in my opinion, behind if you compare it to others, as far as the realtors actually using the tools that get the most exposure, social media, you know, not just posting, here's my listing, but having that strategy behind whatever it is that they're doing, you know, and myself included. Like, it's a relationship business. I'm used to being, you know, feet on the ground as a team too, like with the people. And so, you know, social media, having that website, if you have all referrals, that's not your focus. Your focus is the client appreciation party, right? It's just a different jam there. So I think focusing on your professionalism and really sharpening your saw in that will, no matter what happens, put you in a great position. Things that, you know, you can do to focus on that, you know, are thinking about how you're showing up in your marketplace, from how you're putting out listings to how you're, you know, dressing. Like, if you're out and about meeting with other realtors and, you know, you're showing up in your exercise pants, and it's like, that doesn't cut it anymore. It's time to, like, treat this profession with honor and respect, because you'll get that in return, you know? And so I just think having focus on that will be really crucial going forward.
So, and what do you think the role of teams is playing now in this market, in this day and age, versus, you know, 10 years ago, maybe 15 years ago, the teams weren't as big of a deal. And it was almost like a badge of honor for the agent to do everything themselves.
Right. Yeah. And that's another great question, because I think that the teams allow you to really be in your zone. Yeah. And if you can be in your zone, no matter, I mean, what the splits are, like, it makes sense to be able to just focus on what you do best, right, instead of trying to be everything to everyone. You know, additionally, aligning yourself with a team that is truly interested and wants to elevate you and your goals, not just professionally, but has an interest in seeing you succeed professionally and personally, is also something that, especially because real estate is so crazy and there's so many ups and downs, having that constant of, you know, almost like a little family in your professional world is really important.
Kind of like an on-call therapist.
Exactly. Yes.
So when you work with agents that are coming on that are newer, what are some things that you tell them are, because I know you're into mindfulness and meditation, and I think that's so key, and we can talk for days about that, but what are some things, because with technology, and I'm working on this for 2021, my motto for 2021 is simplification. And I want to also ask you about social media here in a second, but how do you manage, because I think there's the thing that we tell ourselves where we're so busy. Like we tell, oh, my days are always variable. And there's some truth to that. But then there's also some control I can take. But then how do you balance that when you really do work? Like, I don't work with buyers as much. I mainly work with sellers. But I recognize like the buyer's agent role or even the new home sales counselor role, that they're in the model home. It's a very reactive role, right? Because when a home hits the market, if you're not able to show buyers, frankly, that night or that weekend, especially with low inventory levels, they're going to just call someone else usually, right? I mean, let's be real. I mean, I would love to say that there's probably a lot of loyalty, but they want to go look at that house. So if you've got dinner with the family, or you're in the sales office, and let's say you work 10 to 7 or 10 to 6, depending on if you close for daylight savings time. I mean, you're kind of at, it's kind of like a retail store. You're kind of, you've got your job to do in the work in the neighborhood, reports, follow-ups, blah, 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 meetings you've got scheduled. But then you've also got that customer coming in the door, and they don't always have assistance and things to help with that overflow. So how do you coach your agents, or how would you coach somebody listening on managing kind of that, what we tell ourselves, just living in this digital world of, oh, I'm just so busy and overwhelmed, of what's legit busy and what do we have control over? And then how to manage the stuff that, frankly, to be in sales, we just have to do and be reactive.
Yeah. Yeah. So with regards to, you know, time blocking, which is like thing we all want to get our hands around. And it's something we're always, you know, working on improving and integrating and all of that is, if you plan to succeed and you treat and train your clients, because at the end of the day, you're the professional. I think that's what a lot of realtors don't, because the training isn't necessarily there right out of school, is it's easy to forget, you know, that we're the professional. I give the example, you know, of your dentist, your dentist doesn't ask you, right? Yeah.
I use the same example. Yes. Like if you call your dentist, granted, if it's an emergency, that's one thing. But if you call your dentist and say, hey, I need my teeth cleaned, they're going to look at their schedule and put you in where they have availability. But if they say, yeah, can you be here in 30 minutes? I'm going to think, don't y'all have other stuff going on? Like, come on. Right.
Exactly. Yeah. And so, you know, just to be able to discern like what is important and what's not, you know, one example is, I can't tell you how often we get calls after 9 PM from agents that are scheduling showings. Mm-hmm. That is not important enough that it can't be handled at 8:30 when we open, you know? And so just understanding that like that is able to be done next day because everything is on fire and everyone has their hair on fire in real estate. You know, it's so easy to get caught up in everyone else's emergency and just grounding yourself, being able to see that that example isn't, but getting your client into that house that just came on the market is high priority.
Sure.
But you don't have to do it at 8:30 at night. You can, you can control that and build your schedule in a way that on X nights, you're doing this with the family. On other nights, like you're open to those calls and adjust as you have new clients. You know, I think that's something that we don't do enough of, is just that readjustment as your business, even week to week, changes, right? Like just evaluate last week. Okay, I took on these new clients. I need to have a conversation with my family on what nights this week realistically, you know, we can have that dinner, because it is so important to have that every day, right? Because that's the stuff that matters, to your point on simplification and, you know, making space. I think that's a lot of what happens, is we're so busy running all over the place. We don't realize that we're actually not busy, you know, we're busy. We're just not productive, I should say. Yeah.
It's like activity. It's like, is it purposeful? And because we can always be busy. So when you talk to your agents about mindfulness, how do you get them in that mode? Like, how do they start to slow down a little bit? Because again, I think to your point, we'll have agents call us and we have certain standards with offers and the way we process things and when we respond. And part of it's strategy, frankly, versus just time blocking. It's more like, hey, we're going to process offers and do it this way to try to garner highest and best and that kind of thing. But how do you coach them? Because you get a lot of pushback because agents don't have standards. And so their attitude is, well, if I have to work 7 days a week, you should be available 7 days a week. Or if I'm calling you at 10 p.m., you should be available. And it's kind of like, well, I mean, we all run our own business, but what are some of the things that you guide them on as far as setting those standards?
Yeah. So I think, you know, with the other agent is so often I find that the way to, alleviate pushback is just to try to help them understand why I'm doing something or why we're doing something as a team. And so educating them on things like we have to set these standards because of the volume or because we have to bring in that system because of our clients' needs. I think that's really helpful. But just going back to, how do the agents, process things, process those standards? On our team, what's really interesting is that we have a team of agents that are, they've been in the business 9+ years,
sure.
most of us. And one thing that is really consistent is they've been doing it their way for 9+ years. And you have to go through, teaching the old dog the tricks kind of thing. And what's really interesting is if I explain to them the why behind the standard, and I connect it to what it means for them. And the example is, every morning we have our 9 a.m. call and our agents, it's 15 minutes. Our agents go through who they called, leads, where they're at with their sales, pendings. We talk about what we're grateful for, right? And it's just that rapid fire connection as a team and also that accountability. And explaining it to them so that they understand it's not that we, want to micromanage them. It's that if they report their leads and keep a tight track, they're going to be able to do more business.
Right.
So we are actually like our prerogative is to teach them to value themselves and their time, not to run this, tight ship.
Yeah.
Sorry, my voice is going out here. So just tying it back to, how it benefits them, because you see their highest potential. You see their ability to step into this new version of themselves. Mm-hmm. It makes it so, they're asking us to do more of that, which is so how it's so different, compared to how it used to be. Right. It used to feel like I was, pulling them along. And then as soon as I saw, when I connected it in this way, it helped them execute the standard.
No, I love that. So, and I agree with you. When I would work with customers in new home sales or now with listings, telling someone the why behind something is so powerful. If someone would ask me a question and I just answered no, it had a totally different, they took that a totally different way than if I said no, I told them no or yes or whatever the answer was, but and I explained the why behind it. It was like, oh, it just clicked in their head. Like it was just a totally different way we built rapport and communicated. That's a huge point, I think. So you're talking about these agents that have been in the business quite a while, like yourself. Where do you think social media plays? Because I'm really big on personal branding, but then I also am starting to see like, where do you feel like it's the shiny object syndrome and it's just time being spent? Because I do believe to what your point is earlier, which we were talking about relationships. So how do you recommend they use social media to continue with relationships that are meaningful? And or what things do you recommend they share or post versus, okay, you don't need to do this every day because this is, it's great you're there, but it's not going to convert to a sale. It doesn't make anyone feel closer to you. Yes, they know you're a realtor. Does that make sense?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. So one exercise that I went through that helped me in this, answer this question for my team was, what are my core values? And for us, our core values are excellence, boldness, and resourcefulness. And I need to make sure that that is a part of the content that I post because I can then for us just inspiration and education. Like those are the two things that our clients come to us for, right? That's pretty consistent. I think that one, it's so easy because there's so much noise, so much social media, all these people doing different things. It's so easy to, follow that that funnel or that thing that you learned. And I just think it's so important to be you, because I think, for me as well, I got caught up, you know, because it is basically like a second and third job to manage it,
totally, come up with
content and all of that. And I think that as soon as I flipped the switch to think of social media as an extension of me and to have fun with it, it's made a complete difference in it being a second job and a third job to just letting the ideas flow and then just really trying to contribute in everything that we put out.
So from a team standpoint, do you guys put out stuff as a team? Like, these are our listings, these are our closings, from the standpoint of letting your sphere or the geographical area know, hey, we're doing business in your area. And then each agent builds their own little personal brand? Or like, how do you guys structure it? Because I think that's one big thing, whether it's a salesperson with a builder and they're going, okay, my builder's posting stuff as a marketing company, but then should I be posting? Or, and sometimes they have to ask permission, can I be building my own personal brand and building these relationships with realtors and just kind of my community that I'm in? Mm-hmm. And the same thing with agents on teams. Cause that I find that's a real tricky situation as well, because it's kind of like, okay, does my team post my property post? Do I post them? Is that bad? So I have my own thoughts, but I'm curious to see what you think about kind of those posts as an agent and then as a team / organization.
Yeah, I think as a team, it's really important that, you know, it's the team's brand. Even if the agent is on site, at the end of the day, that's the team's client. And for the agent to, you know, be building a personal brand with the team's client, that's just not, in my mind, professional. I always look at things like, you know, would I do that? I wouldn't feel comfortable doing that. So therefore.
So you think it's weird? Do you think it's weird to friend, like, if you are working with a seller, do you think it's weird to go on Facebook and friend them?
Not necessarily, no.
Okay.
I think that is great. And also builds that rapport. You know, mm-hmm. I think that as far as like what you share or how you use that to manage a transaction, we don't use that, you know, per se. But I think that there's opportunity to, in friending them, you know, asking them if there's anyone that they know that you can help, you know, in creating some creative like associations, you know, where you can utilize this platform to get more business instead of just posting post to post.
Right. Right. So when you guys come up with content, are you working at a team level or are you also coaching your agents on a personal brand level?
So they typically just share the team posts onto their page.
Okay.
And we make sure that all of their, you know, information about information obviously is, you know, current with their current headshot and everything. So it's all on brand that way. But that's how we run it. And I mean, we're definitely in the process of up-leveling a lot of this because it has not been
our
focus.
It's like a daily base. I think it's a daily struggle, to be honest.
Yeah. It definitely is. Like the idea of doing it in like 2 week increments or trying to do like one day, you know, a month of just like a brain dump of all of the things you want to post that, I mean, definitely help, but.
Yeah. And then are you seeing like, because I think relationships are key. So whether it's client appreciation events, you know, your referral partners, those events or gifts or that kind of thing, are you seeing social media really build better relationships, or do you think it's just what we're doing because we feel like it's necessary as an extension of our website to kind of be known out there? Because like, you know, if you buy a Coca-Cola, like, is it because you saw the billboard, the commercial, you know, that kind of thing? I think people have to see you enough times to make the association. Do you think social media is helping to build the relationship or just kind of build that know, like, and trust factor? Or do you think it's just kind of more of a passive, like, okay, they see you enough times to where, but the relationship building, it still needs to be done in different ways that are more, you know, personal, face-to-face, phone calls, text messages, that kind of thing.
Yes. So I agree with the latter. So I think we are leaning too much on social media as a passive approach because it's not being actively used, you know, strategically, you know, for most real estate agents. And what I think the focus needs to be is a focus on connection with people because, I mean, especially with everything that's happened this year,
yeah,
there's such a deep feeling of
you know, being disconnected and trying to navigate this new norm, that doing the stuff that's like the basics. I mean, Popeyes, I can't remember if it was Mike's podcast or a different podcast, but they were talking about, you know, that their agent had dropped by sanitizers, like little Popeyes that agents like used to. I mean, I remember when I first started, I would drop off Lincoln Logs to builders to try and like, hey, remember when you were young? Like, just like that stuff. But I think we've gone too much away from that because we're so connected, but we're really so disconnected, you know, so lean more on that. And maybe creating a strategy where you have the social working with your scheduled Popeyes, client appreciations, whatever those things are, so that they're, you know, in alignment and also working off of each other.
Right. Right. So when you have a new agent coming in, let's talk about goal setting. And as we, because we're going to be, like we talked about earlier in the show, we're going to be airing this kind of at the beginning of the year. So what are the things that you have them focus on? Actually, let's not talk about a new agent because you're working with agents that are seasoned. And I think a lot of people listening to this, they've been in new home sales for a while. They've been agents for a while. So how do you kind of, okay, it's the ninth year that maybe they've done this, 10th year, maybe they've done this. Like, how do you get them motivated versus just, okay, I want to increase my sales by 10% this next year. Like, okay, great. Like, or how do you do it for yourself? Maybe that's a better question.
Yeah. And it's such a great question just because the strategy that I used, you know, end of last year into this year was different compared to other years in that I went deeper with the agents and the buy-in and results has been 180 degrees different, maybe 360. And it's something that is, it's really easy to break down if you're an agent or even a team lead. So what we do is we first talk about, you know, what is it that you want? And it's so easy to label success as I want to make $100,000 as an example. And what's really important is to identify that for sure, but ask yourself, is that really what you want? Or is that what you perceive success to be?
Yeah.
And so just checking yourself. So, you know, set that goal, check yourself, and then connect it to that why. You know, you hear about like, what's your big why? And I think we don't take the time to actually figure that out for ourselves. We are, let's just get into achievement mode, more, more, more. And you get to that point where you're like, okay, I have all of this success and I feel largely unfulfilled, like something is missing. And so talking about that and just talking about like, who do you want to be? Like, what is your vision? Not just for your business, but your family life, your, you know, your spiritual, mindful, like that aspect. Because if you connect all the pieces when they aren't feeling like it, you know, or times get tough, they are able to tap into that purpose, right? So just really creating that purposeful plan, to achieve that. So that's the first step is to go deeper on that and to also get in touch with what do you want to specialize in? You know, a lot of times real estate agents, you know, they get started and it's like, okay, let's go. I know for me, I mean, I was doing 15 different types of lead generation to start because I knew if I worked all those verticals, I would get results.
Right.
And then as I got experienced, I narrowed down to the new construction, you know, in the seller side. But what I wish I would have known then is to ask myself when I'm doing the goal setting and business planning, what am I really good at and what do I love?
I love that. I love that. It's so simple.
Yes.
But it's so like sometimes we gloss over the simple stuff because we're looking for a silver bullet that's shiny and complicated.
Yes, exactly. Everyone
I also think it's
shortcut.
Yeah. Well, I also think, I don't know, I grew up thinking work was work, right? Like we're supposed to strive and it's supposed to be difficult and you're supposed to kind of dread it. And it's like, what if you could do the things you love to do? And it's almost like, oh, I feel guilty now, you know? So what do you want to do? What lights you up?
For example, you know, people that are like very social, you know, do not focus on expired listing cold calls, focus on networking, you know, what groups can you join in open houses, because you thrive and get energized by being with people. Right. So taking that moment to ask yourself, okay, out of all of these types of lead generation, like, who am I? And when I'm my happiest, like, what am I doing? Because if you connect your efforts to that, it will also carry you through. The next thing is, once you identify that, pick 1 to 3 types of lead generation that you're going to do.
Okay.
And, you know, in the spirit of your word of simplification, if you simplify and really focus on 1 to 3 sources and be an expert, you will gain such traction. If you're a new agent or a seasoned agent, this is applicable. You know, it's like, you'll gain such traction that you'll be seen as consistent, as the professional, and get that recognition, you know, when everyone else is trying to keep up with the Joneses, like trying to be that next social media.
Right. Expert. Whiz kid.
Yeah.
So when you talk about that 1 to 3 sources. So let's say a source is new construction, like you said. Yeah. Are you then coaching your agent on, I'm just gonna like, okay, we talk about social media and things you want to share content related. I totally am with you on the, you want to educate, inspire. And then there's this third one that's entertain. And I don't feel like I'm that entertaining. So I like staying in this little realm, and I educate's like the best, because I'm very black and white, and I'm like, ooh, let's just do value-based. So are you coaching them on, okay, if this is your source that you're going to focus on, are you trying to help them build like their brand and authority and their kind of like expertise around like, okay, do a video series on, you know, frequently asked questions. Like, how are they doing that and building up that notoriety, I guess?
Yeah. So one example is, you know, the agent that's out at one of our planned communities, you know, it's very easy to look at that as your lead source, right? You have this planned community and listings there.
Okay.
Well, that, and it's, the way I look at it is, that's already done. That community is in your mind. It needs to be looked at as like, that's already like secured. And so you need to generate that new business, whether that's doing that video series, whether that's, you know, those networking groups or what have you. So yeah, definitely what we do is we actually take what their goals are and then break it down to tell them exactly how many people they need to be calling every day.
Okay.
Conversions and all of that, which then they would pick whichever type of, you know, lead gen that they want to pursue. Mm-hmm. But absolutely, whether it's, you know, relocation, being that point of contact for all of the Costcos or all of the Walmarts, like whatever that strategy is, we definitely work with them to promote that.
And really niche down.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. And then I wanted to touch on, because I'm just really curious, the limitless mindset and meditation that you help your agents with, and I'm sure you practice yourself. So can you share a little bit about that?
Yeah, of course. So I go to India. I haven't gone in a while, obviously. Don't know when I'll go back. But just was exposed to, you know, meditation and this and mindfulness early in my life. And I'm super grateful to have been able to, you know, go to India and just learn this deeper to bring back to the team and the world. Like that's really my mission, is I would just want to wake people up. And so the limitless mindset and meditation and the practice is, I call it the triple threat system. And so what that is, focus on in the first step, 3 things that you're grateful for. And, really to do that, it sets your mind right. You know, you start the day, if you're doing this in the morning, which I recommend, just on what's right instead of what's wrong. And then do in the next step, a 3-minute conscious breathing practice, which is simply deep inhalations and deep exhalations. You can set a timer for 3 minutes on your phone. And so imagine, you know, you're tending the soil and planting these, you know, good thoughts in the morning to then build your day upon. And then in the last step, looking at my short and long-term goals so that I've, you know, tended the garden, planted these positive seeds, and that is what I'm now building the, you know, house, if you will, mm-hmm. of the goals upon, and also keeping that focus each day so that I am not spending time on the things that don't equal those short and right. long-term goals. With regards to, you know, that limitless mindset and how we interweave it within the team is in many different ways, but just a few examples, you know, is pointing out the language that our team members are using mm-hmm. and whatever excuses or stories or mm-hmm. programs, you know, are running them, calling them out as I see them and trying to encourage them to see the truth in themselves. Because when you are clear inside and you know, can see whatever it is that's bothering you and be free because of it, you are able to make decisions in such a different way that you truly do become limitless. You don't have the baggage weighing you down of your beliefs, the old story. You know, you can create a new beginning, not in 2021, but actually, you know, or 2022 or 2023. Like, you can actually, it's just a decision. It's just a decision today of who do I want to be and how do I want to show up and just start that new story and design that so you can step into the person that you want to become instead of letting the default programs run you and control how you show up in the world and what you achieve.
Love it. Love it. Especially because, like we talked about earlier, real estate in particular, I mean, a lot of industries can be chaotic, but this is one of the most reactive and chaotic industries, especially when the market's good. It's almost like this double-edged sword of people are like, how's real estate? And it's like, it's great, but then I've got this new level of problems and nobody feels sorry for you. But it is a different level when you're super busy and clients are calling and homes are selling and multiple offers and that kind of thing. It's a good problem to have, but it just creates a different problem.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I find, you know, if you see the truth of like the problem and you can address it, then it doesn't keep showing up with a different mask. Cause that's really what happens. You know, I always find that my real estate business is my mirror, and because I'm spending all my time in it, right? I'm not maybe going out with my friends or, you know, like that's my focus. My clients are going to show me the stuff that I need to work through. So it's kind of like a personal development journey in the real estate career.
Yeah, no, I love it. So I ask each guest 5 questions. And then before we go, we'll get all your social links and information. But what's one thing that most people don't know about you?
I love Pedialyte.
Oh my God. That's so random. I know. I love it. Do you do it for dehydration or you just like the taste of it?
Both. Yep.
Okay. Okay. Do you drink it a certain time of day or is it just random depending on if you have it?
You know, it's random. It is definitely like, yeah, it's not something like I always have on hand, but yeah. I do try to like weave it into my grocery orders at least once a month. It's like a little treat.
Do you get like an energy boost off of it or?
No, it's, you know, it's funny. I've started juicing lately, okay. You know, trying to integrate that more and more. And so what's funny is I clearly wasn't getting the nutrients. And so I was drinking a ton of water. So the Pedialyte was like, I was dehydrated, right?
Right.
But as I've juiced and had more of those nutrients and the water, it's like, I don't like it as much, but it's something I've always loved. I think it's that probably Kool-Aid flavor with not many calories.
Mm-hmm. What are you noticing any benefits of juicing?
You know, I am. And it's funny. I was talking to my energy doctor about this recently and he had made that observation, you know, of when you do juicing or, you know, eat plant-based, much more you're putting in the system, which obviously makes sense, you know, when you talk about it, but you don't realize that it's just like you're thirsty. So you go for the water, but the benefits have definitely been, you know, not needing as much caffeine, overall just feeling better, you know, skin looking better, all of that.
Yeah. Sorry, random question. I'm super interested. So I do keto, so I do low sugar, but with juicing, are you using a lot of fruits? Are you using more vegetables? So is it lower sugar? Or are you watching your sugar on that?
So I'm just doing carrot, mm-hmm. lemon, and apple sometimes, but usually it's just carrot, lemon,
integrating apple, cucumber, and then I don't do much spinach. So those are really the key.
Yeah. Nice. Ones. Oh, that's awesome. Yeah. And then question two is two part. What's the best piece of advice you've ever received?
I would say I provide, or we provide, you decide. It's something that someone had shared with me early on in my career. And it's been the thing. It's our mantra today of educating our clients and letting them know we're going to give you all the info and then you get to decide. So they're empowered. Yeah.
Love it. Love it. And then what's the best piece of advice you would like to give the audience today?
I would just say that anything is truly possible for you. And that's talked about a lot, but anything that, you know, is a hiccup in your path or troubles you or is a limiting belief or a limiting situation, if you ask yourself how you're contributing to that and are willing to go deep and reflect, you will see how you're contributing to it and be able to course correct and tell whatever that thing is to get out your way. So I would just say, if you can, you know, be courageous, which, like, that's what we're born to be, and see how you're, you know, key piece to the problem, you are the solution.
Love that. Especially in this year, right? Because I think a lot of us have felt so powerless. That lends itself to you still have control and you still have the power. Okay. What's one of your favorite books or the one that's had the greatest impact? What comes to mind?
You know, The Success Principles by Jack Canfield. Yeah. It was just like the first book that I read, you know, as I started my career, and one that no matter what's happening is great to remember.
Can I always go back to? Yeah. What's your current morning routine?
So I wake up, I grab my Earl Grey tea, and I come into my meditation room. I meditate. I go through, you know, the triple threat system.
Uh-huh.
I read, and then I do my workout and then get ready. I do want to figure out how some women get ready in 30 to 45 minutes. If anyone,
I'm with you on that. I'm okay. I need like the whole hour at least. Yes, what time do you normally get up? I know a lot of agents and salespeople are going to be like, what time does she get up? Cause our role, you can go a little later cause we work later in the night, but are you an early riser?
I am. Yeah. So 5:30 to 6 is my ideal time frame.
Okay. And then random again, I'm just reading a book called Glow 15. By, I can't remember the name of the author, but she basically talks about, it's about burning fat and glowing skin and all this stuff. But she starts off every morning with her autophagy tea, and it's Earl Grey with a bergamot.
Oh yeah.
Organic bergamot. And then it's green tea, a cinnamon stick, and a teaspoon of coconut oil. And she has a certain schedule, but I just ordered Earl Grey tea with bergamot today, organic.
Oh, that's
awesome. Yeah. So I'm super excited. Yeah,
I'm going to check that out. That sounds delicious.
Yeah, I'll send you some info. Okay, last question. Yeah. How do you unplug and unwind?
Definitely through meditation and mindfulness and reflection. I just love taking the time to do that, and it really helps me unwind.
When you do meditation, do you do guided, or are you trained enough to where you can just do it on your own and go through like a series?
Okay. Yeah. There are processes that I have been trained on and going to India, you know, that I can go through. But it's always so funny, you know, it's so easy to share that with others. It's like when you're trying to unwind, I know for me, it's like, it's easier sometimes when I'm all like wound up to listen to guided.
No, same here. All right. So if people want to get a hold of you, if they want to connect with you and learn more about what you do for other agents, they want to know more about the Limitless Realtor Circle, how can they connect with you?
The best way is to go to my website, which is limitlesswithstacyb.com, because my last name is very long. People call me Stacy B, most people that know me. So again, limitlesswithstacyb.com.
Okay, cool. And then anything, are you on Instagram or Facebook or LinkedIn or anything?
Yes.
I can connect with you on?
It's easiest just to go to that website because—
Oh, okay. The social icons. Yep. Oh, I gotcha. No worries. Well, thank you so much for today. I think this is going to be perfect airing in early January, talking about goal setting, talking about getting back in touch with your why versus just, I want to do more business. And if you do, that's great. I'm not saying that's a bad thing. It's just, but keeping in mind, like, what does this really mean to you as a person, for your family? It's not just a career thing, but I think that's really important, especially like we talked about in this industry. And then the evolution of the real estate agent, really taking care of your clients, really showing up as a professional. And I think not treating it like a part-time job, right? Like, yes, you can show up in exercise pants, but even if it's a friend, like, show, how would you want your doctor to show up, right? Like, right. If I'm going in for surgery and it's a friend, I still expect them to show up a certain way for me to feel comfortable. And so I think that's so important because, again, we don't have the standards thrust upon us as real estate agents. So we have to kind of do that ourselves. And it's easy, I know, especially with COVID, to get a little bit more lax. But I think that's a good reminder that we are professionals. It, at least in Texas, I would always say the barrier to entry is kind of low. You know, you don't have to do a whole lot to get a license. But really taking it upon yourself to educate, maybe go take more classes or courses, build that professionalism, build those standards, because people do notice. And I think also how you show up online, like with social, I've said it before, I would rather do less social media, but have it be better quality. Unless it's the stories or something where it's kind of meant to be a little bit more casual. Mm-hmm. I just really feel like, you know, I don't know if you'd agree, but I saw this thing on LinkedIn and it was a professional woman and it had a lot of views. This post had a lot of views and she basically had her normal headshot and she had taken it down and she had put up a picture of herself taken from her phone. Her roots were grown out, no makeup. Like, it looked like she just woken up and she basically said, this is how I look today. I want to be my authentic self. And I thought, you know, I get it, but at the same point in time, you don't have to show up as that squeaky clean professional, like buttoned all the way up if that's not you, but let's find a balance because I still think you can be authentic, but still show up professional. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. Because authenticity is not external, right? And that's where people get confused. Authenticity is an internal game. And so that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about, to your point, professionalism. And we have a joke within our team. It's like, how would you be and how would you dress if you were meeting the queen, because right. That's how you need to show up. Because why not? Like, why not be the best version of yourself and like go all out?
Well, and I look at it, and this is going a little bit long, but I look at it too, like, you know, I just celebrated my 15th wedding anniversary and I looked at my husband and I'm like, I still want to like put on makeup and look good for you. But I'm like, no offense, babe. I want to look good for me. I want to feel good about me and have that confidence. And I think as professionals in real estate, like that's so important because people judge you and your success. Doesn't mean you have to have the most expensive car or the most expensive handbag, but they judge how you show up because they're comparing how you show up to how you're going to take care of them, right? So if you show up in a dirty car and maybe not so nice clothes or not so put together, are they going to think, how are they going to stage my house and list it right? Or how are they going to negotiate my contract? Are they going to be scattered there and forget details like they are in their own personal life? So I think you're right. I think it's really important because perception is reality.
Yes. And I love the saying that we judge ourselves by our intentions.
Yes.
Other people judge us by our actions.
Yes.
So I think that that's also helpful, you know?
Yeah. And I think in this world where everyone's trying to be so authentic, it's like, I don't know. I think the pendulum needs to shift the other way just a hair. You know, yes. I don't need to know every single thought in your head. You know what I mean? That doesn't mean just because you don't share, it doesn't mean you're not being authentic, but that's another point for another day. But
totally.
Thank you so much for joining us. I know, like, just so you guys know, we have been trying to set this meeting up for like 3.5 months. There's been different things happen. So we've had to course correct, but I'm so excited. It all happens in the right time. So I wasn't worried about it, but I am so appreciative for you being on the show today. Thank you for your time. It's been very insightful and I'm sure everyone got a lot out of it.
Thank you for the opportunity. I'm glad we made this happen.
Me too.